My name is Bethany Dixon from Rockland, California, and I teach at Western Sierra Collegiate Academy, a Rockland Academy family school, and this is NASA Now.
Hi, I'm Maria, and this is NASA Now. During the course of this season, we are going to take a look at some of the exciting career opportunities available at NASA. In today's program, we catch up with teacher-turned-astronaut Dottie Metcalf-Lindenburger and see what it takes to go from the classroom to low Earth orbit. That's ahead, but first, here's what's happening at NASA Now.
A lasting legacy on the moon. NASA's Gravity Recovery and Interior Laboratory, or GRAIL, successfully completed its mission to study differences in the moon's gravity. On December 17, 2012, GRAIL's two spacecraft, Ebb and Flow, successfully impacted the lunar surface after their scheduled descent. The site was named the Sally K. Ride Impact Site in honor of the late NASA astronaut, Dr. Sally Ride, America's first female in space. Dr. Ride, who passed away in July 2012, also led the mission's MoonCam program, the first camera on a planetary mission dedicated entirely to education and public outreach. MoonCam took more than 115,000 images of the lunar surface. Imaging targets and the spacecraft names were selected from student submissions across the country. Following the mission, images were returned to the students for further study.
She was a mission specialist on the crew of STS-131 and spent over 2 weeks on board the ISS. So what was it like to go from being a teacher to an astronaut, and how in the world did she get there? Those are some of the questions we will answer when Dottie Metcalf-Lindenburger shares her incredible career.
Since I've been here at NASA, I've been living my dream, and it's been quite exciting. I've met many new people, learned so much about our space shuttle, which is now retired, about the International Space Station, and I'm learning more now about our international partners and the vehicles that we're using to supply our International Space Station. One day, when I was teaching my high school class, one of my students asked me, "How do you go to the bathroom in space?" It's a great question. I didn't know what that toilet looked like. So I went to the NASA website. I found out just what the shuttle toilet looked like, learned how you can use it, and at the same time, they were posting for teachers to become astronauts. I thought, this is a perfect job. So I applied. I knew that it would be very unlikely that I'd get the job. But again, I set my goals high and I worked hard. There's not one single day that's ever the same. Whether we're in classes learning about systems of the International Space Station or how the new visiting vehicles work, or whether we're in our Russian classes learning the other language of the space station. Sometimes we're flying out in a T-38 and practicing checklists and how to work as a team in a very real environment. Sometimes we're in the neutral buoyancy lab and we're practicing 6-hour-long spacewalks underwater because it's the closest that we can get to being in a simulated weightlessness. Other times we're in front of lots of video screens and practicing robotics because the best way for us to do our robotics is through simulators. And so all of those things are ways that we have a different daily schedule. And then in between there, we have desk jobs too, where we're supporting those people that are flying in space. When you're in space, from the very first moment that you start to feel this weightlessness, you start to get this fluid shift, and all the fluids start to go up towards your head and into places that they normally don't, because, you know, here on Earth, fluids shift down due to gravity. And at first this makes you feel really stuffy. It can make you feel a little bit nauseous because your stomach's floating up where it's not normally at. And it just takes a matter of a day or so before you start to feel pretty normal. That's the amazing thing about your brain, is that it starts to recognize what the new normal is and adapt to it. then you have to figure out some other things to do for your body. For instance, taking care of like brushing your teeth, putting your contacts in, washing your hair, using the bathroom, all of these things take a little bit more effort than they do here on Earth. I want you to be just as equally excited about science, engineering, and math, and technology. And here's why. Because we're going places. NASA's got big dreams too, and I hope you do too. We're thinking about exploring beyond low Earth orbit, and we're trying to build spacecraft that'll get us there. And so you guys are gonna be the ones that go explore for us. And we're gonna be using your minds and your dreams to propel us further and further into our solar system.
Did you know that space is anything but empty? In fact, there's a corrosive gas called atomic oxygen that exists in low Earth orbit and is helping to restore artwork and clean surgical implants right here on Earth. In an effort to learn more about atomic oxygen and the negative effects it has on satellites and spacecraft, NASA scientists discovered that this corrosive gas could help restore fire-damaged artwork and remove bacterial contaminants from surgical implants. Now you know.
If you would like to join the team at NASA, just like astronaut Dottie Metcalf-Lindenburger, there's no better time to plot your career path than now.
Teachers, you can point your students towards a great career website where they can explore a variety of opportunities that exist at NASA. You can find it by checking out the extension activity for this program on the NASA Explorer School's virtual campus.
Well, that's it for NASA Now. Be sure to visit our Facebook page and leave a comment. We'll see you next time on NASA Now.
NASA Now comes to you from the virtual campus at NASA Explorer School.